what else? And how and when we can we do them? So shouldn't be only one thing, right? Yeah. So why don't we just get divide into three groups, and since there are like three boards.
Yeah.
Okay. So how do you guys think?
That sounds good to me. So you guys all okay with that?
Yeah.
So we divide into three groups. My.
Like three circles or.
So it's way to decide that would be how 1 2 3 1 2 3. Yeah.
Oh yeah. This is doable as well.
Okay, you three groups, I would like you to have 10 minutes to be able to come up with the final answers. And then after that, you have 1 minute to present to the class for each question. So total of 2 minutes, yeah? And then we select the best, okay? And then present to the whole auditorium. Sound good? You got the whole information? You got 10 minutes. To do this discussion, and then you select your presenters, and you have 2 minutes to present those two questions to the rest of the class, and then we select the best, and then present to the whole auditorium. Good? Great. Okay, now, 1, 2, 3, start. You have 7 minutes and 20 seconds left. Don't forget that you have two questions and you have to prepare for the presentation as well. You can select whatever you want. This is up to your imagination. Sorry to interrupt, there's 4 minutes left. 4 minutes left. So if you're not touching on the second question, you might want to do so. And don't forget that you have to select presenters and the presentation is freestyle. You can present the way, whatever way you want. You have 2 minutes remaining. There's 1 minute and 30 seconds left. Second. No pressure. Second remaining. Second remaining. Ten second remaining. All right. Five, four, three, two, one. So we are ready? Well, we don't have much time here, but whatever we can, then I know this is not gonna be fair, but they're probably the best way to select the best group, or the first group to actually, that's okay, that's just iPhone. that's just iPhone. That's just, for the first group to present, I'm gonna ask you to select it.
And the first group who have to be selected to be presented is the group three.
Group three, aww. Yay! So we don't have much time. What we will do is we cut down to 90 seconds each. Okay, 90 seconds. Are you ready? Who's gonna be the presenter? Yeah. You're gonna be who?
You may turn the flip card.
And by the way, I have imported the judge of the, how many judges we have?
Two.
We have two judges. Anybody would like to volunteer to be another judge there? Dr. Duong, we have here you guys, we have literally 15 minutes left. So look, this, would you like to tell the,
okay. Okay, we can have color card. If after the pitch, we will give you feedback. If you get the red one, it means that your pitch wasn't strong enough to convince the judges, okay? If you get the yellow, means that we are not sure, we need a bit more time to think about it. And if you get the green one, it means that your idea was excellent and we want to buy your idea, okay? Is that clear? Yep.
The red. Are you ready? 90 seconds each, okay?
Okay, so one of the biggest things that I suppose is a fairy tale for every scientist is to be able to travel to another place in the universe, to be able to get out there and see what it's really like in other worlds. So I guess that is something that is a really huge fairy tale for scientists and for science fiction writers and people alike. Did you want to add to that?
Okay, so these 10 are actually our targets, and we decided to do the toughest one, which is university traveling. And our universe traveling is actually enables us from traveling from galaxy to galaxy through spacecrafts that are equipped with really good engines. There is gonna be available in several hundreds of years, and they will be really powerful because they will have the technology that we are still developing, like quantum physics or related to something. Something.
Maybe using some sort of a self-sustaining fuel, so something that can keep being recycled, so that it's not something that we need to store then on the ship, and we can then focus on finding exoplanets and searching for another place maybe where we can expand human life.
We actually talked about the possibility that with this kind of technology, we can expand and we can find like other planets to be. So,
okay, well, I give you yellow and.
Thank you so much.
Yellow and green between it, all right?
Okay, thank you. Okay, we'll work very hard.
Okay. So yellow, green, and green. Now,
next one is?
The next one will be...
Number two. Who's the presenter?
Okay, the topic that we are going to basically deal out of all the fairy tale topics is basically immortality, or we can say death to life. Basically, we want to have a long life without any diseases, any epidemics, and we have to create such a sustainable materials in the near possible future so that they can have a covering around the skin and they can regrow itself in a very short period of time. As there has been research on cell growth and cell development, but the main important point that we are lacking at this moment is that they take very long to grow. So we have to work on some specific enzymes that should be used to catalyze the reaction in a really fast level. As we all know about starfish, if its muscle is being cut, it can regrow in time. So basically the cells are there, the basic purpose and the basic connection is there in the nature, as nature is telling us a lot of things. So we just have to improve it a little bit.
All right, about this death to life and immortality, we can improve our biotechnology, that we can make a little cell from body to develop it into an organ or a body, so that we can get death to life by get a cell from that body and make it into a human again. But we can't. All right, thank you very much.
So I'm not sure that it's good to be, you know, forever. So you have to find a point of where you want to be forever.
Oh, yes, but we haven't finished, so you may not know what I just want to know, say now.
Okay, sorry, you have to wrap up.
I just want to say something about our morality in our society. Of course, we can't make total immortality, but we can expand our longevity and so that we can do more things and get more experience from the elderly.
But the problems right now for us is
I know the population
yeah.
growth, and I think if we can deal with this We can get a Facebook.
I think your time is up. You can think again.
Oh no! I just want to tell you. You can give me yellow. Yeah, I have no. So listen to me, okay? Thank you very much for giving me this chance. Yes, 10 seconds. I think we can get a feasible way so that we can travel to Earth, travel to the universe, or get some other sources, just like we can use fusion energies, so that we can get enough sources for this.
It's really good, but it's not debate. So, but that's, you know what? I was going to give this group yellow, but seeing the passion, I'm gonna go with yellow and green.
Oh, thank you very much.
I am a nice guy. I'm gonna give you the green one.
Oh, thank you.
The reason is I agree with the first judge that living forever is not a good idea because, you know, nature, it must. We should have natural selection, and we have to die. But the idea is very good in case you have diseases that you lost organs or tissues, you need to regrow them. It's a very good idea, right? And currently there is this technology called tissue engineering. You might know it, but it takes time. We need to speed it up, and if you can do it, it's going to be very good. Okay.
Yes. Thank you.
Should we move this, or okay? You want to help me? Are we good? Okay. Yes, I think we're ready. So we actually came up with the idea from James and the Giant. Oh, not James and the Giant Beanstalk. Jack and the Beanstalk, and we thought of magic beans. And we thought, well, we've actually already kind of got magic beans with genetically modified organisms. And if we could expand on our knowledge of this and increase the potential of photosynthesis, we could actually be able to create carbo nanotube elevators. We could solve world hunger if we can genetically modify these plants to grow to, you know, exponential growths. And this could actually be a great thing for humanity. We think that it would probably take about 20 to 30 years, given that we have already got these genetically modified crops available already. We just need to harness the knowledge. Anything you want to add?
Yeah, exactly. With the advancing technology throughout the years, we can build carbon nanotube elevator. And we know that the nanoparticles have extremely good capability to carry weight. And so they are going to be extremely stable, and we can make them very high. And so they are going to lift up so great heights. And we are taking this up because we are going to focus on a more realistic object.
So we think this is with
the modern technology, we only got 20 to 30 years before we can reach this idea. And this is a very prospective idea, and we can think that the world will be greatly benefited by it. But yeah.
Oh, thank you.
What a listen is that? Well, I love the presentations. Wrap up within those 90 seconds really nicely. And also, I think I like how when she talk about this whole idea, it come from some inspiration. And it's always good when scientists have some inspirations, and it's a good story. And plus, I think it's achievable, and it's something that we definitely excited about. So green for me.
Thank you very much.
I'm going to give you the green one.
Oh, thank you.
Because food security is a hot issue right now, and you picked the right topic to work on. And it would bring benefits to all of us because the population keep increasing all the time, and we have limited resources. Good idea.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
I'll give you a green one. I think this is a major problem of the world, so we have to find a food supply. We all need food. you know, more than full and everything. So we have to leave. And then you have a very good presentation, wrap up the reason and problem and everything. So it's good.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, Matt.
Thank you all.
So I guess we got the winning team, but before we, well, I guess you have to prepare to give this summaries of your question to the whole class. But before we wrap up this section, I would like to get just a couple comments from you guys. What do you learn from this discussion? Any volunteer? Oh my God, I'm not Professor Yong-Yut. Everybody was just pointing their hand up. Any volunteer to give a comment what you learned from this activity, please, before someone coming in? Oh, thank you. You saved my world.
I consider time distribution as a very important factor for us. Whatever in discussion or in presentation is a very good, it's a very critical factor for us to express ourselves. If we didn't distribute the time correctly, maybe we have our very good ideas, but we can't express it out. That's it. Thank you.
Give her a round of applause. That's a really good comment. One more comment, please.
Hello. I do think that time control is very important because I was the time controller, and I was like, we got 10 ideas, but we didn't have much time to finish them. But I still learned a very, very important lesson that we are really creative, and we actually can think of a lot of things. So next time, I'll probably, if I have this kind of responsibility, I'll just do a better job. And I want to thank my partner. She's really good. That's all.
One more comment.
This time we have 7 topics, and I have got to know that group 3 has 10 topics, so that I have thought that maybe the first group, they just have only one topic, right?
We did actually find a second topic, but we decided to not include it because we didn't have enough time to talk
about
it.
They only concentrate in one thing or in very small things, but we waste a lot of time in doing this, and we didn't concentrate on one thing, so that we may have something that it's not very satisfying, yeah. So next time, I think we have the experience so that we can do better. All right, thank you.
Thank you. Any more comment? One more.
So the one thing I just learned after all the presentations is that like to have a good idea and to convince people of it are two different stories. And so, just like you said, like the reason that they successfully convey the idea was that they seem to speak from some kind of inspiration. And I think that we can all like display our own inspiration. I believe we're all inspired here, and we can all display our own inspiration if we truly like believe in our idea and like believe in the realization of it. Thank you.
So I would like to wrap this up with that I'm really impressed how you work really efficiently within 10 minutes. Think about 10 minutes. You get so much out of it. And you learn so quickly of how actually work together as a group that you might not know each other. So I'm really impressed with that. Now, you two, you have a job. That was 90 seconds. But you have to make that to 10 minutes. Oh, you can just do 5 minutes, but I trust that, you know, with your energy that we'll send to them, they can do it, right? Yeah. Yay! So, thank you all, and now you can get your seat first before other group comes in, yeah? Thank you really much.
So please sit at the place you were before you separate into the small groups. Please sit at a group you were before you went to the small groups. Please sit at a place you were before you split into small groups. So now we're waiting for a class. We're waiting for a group one from 305. And for the other people, please sit at the place you were before you split into small groups. Thank you.
Class A, please come back to the same seat before you go to the room. Class A, if you're already here, please go back to the same seat so then we can start the conclusion. Class A, go back to seat on the same seat before you left this room so then we can start the conclusion.
Okay, now we are back, I guess. Okay, this time, because we have something like half an hour, because we divide into three questions, and then, well, we're going to have representative of each group to come to, you know, present what you have discussed among your friends. And we have discussion, and Professor Ingrid Geng could give comments also. Okay, how about we start from group number one? Who's going to talk on group number one? Oh. Okay. Depends. Okay. Group one. Group one. Who is group one? Group number one. It's you. Come. Come in front. Group number one, I mean, who is going to present? No one? Okay. Come here. Come here. Okay. So, okay, and do you have scripture to show? No?
Here.
You don't have it?
I have notes here.
You have the note? Okay, try to explain very well to your friends then. Okay?
Sorry?
You have to try to explain very well to your friend because you don't have the scripture to show.
Okay,
go. I think you have. You're going to only one from group one?
No, I mean, like, I want you to explain a bit. Yeah,
more here? How many? Four. God, you have 2 minutes each. No, 1.5
minutes. 1.5
minutes? 90 seconds, go.
So I'm gonna talk about what is the common factors between the social evolution and the biological evolution. So I think that biological evolution is mainly talk about the survival of the fittest. So basically in this case, means that whichever is stronger or more popular will win. For example, like people nowadays are prefer to use social media and their gadgets to communicate and act for their social life instead of using the old-fashioned way of hanging out, like talking to their friends in the cafe and etc. So I think that the change in the technological stimulates the social evolution for all of us. 9 seconds.
We'll be talking about. So we'll be talking about legal evolution, and basically this is the evolution of law and politics that we have. This is highly dependent on social evolution as well. Basically, if we can understand what is legal evolution, is this. In the medieval ages, we used to have these monarchies, right? The sort of imbalancing of certain classes. But in today's age, we have democracies, which is more balanced in comparison. This is a gradual change of law and politics, which causes this legal evolution. Also, that just like how in biology predators have predators have more power in comparison to their prey. Similarly, in this legal evolution, there are like the riches have more say in the law in comparison to the lesser income people. For example, but eventually, also law does not change overnight. Since it's gradual, it will also the law enforcement is more gradual in comparison to the law itself. And finally, we'll keep on changing the legal evolution, because just like in biological evolutions, we need to keep up the spirit of living. Or as we know it in biology, the hybrid vigor. We need the spirit of living, and thus we will keep on changing gradually. Thank you.
I think I have one big point.
Does that cover the time?
Yes, four. Yeah. You guys?
No.
So can I add one more? I have still, okay. So the other example is like the evolution also talks about that we people tend to adapt to be accepted or to be better. For example, 100 years ago, people are less productive than people nowadays. Like we see in the big cities, or people are walking very fastly. They will bump into each other without saying sorry. Yeah, so like they need to adapt in order to get to not to get left behind. Like if you're slow in your work, like you will like get left behind and will not get any job. So I think that's it.
We also have this social evolution that I mentioned. Basically, to understand what social evolution is, it's also that we as people keep on growing just as much as science grows. Just as science keeps growing, we tend to get more rational. As rational as we get, we will turn to change different laws and law systems, and thus we will, as social people, as social animals, evolve as well.
Thank you very much. First of all, it's amazing that you have accomplished such a lot in such a short time. This is quite a difficult subject because it goes out of science, but it uses science, especially very important theory in science, you know, theory of evolution as a basis. And I think the society in general have adopted the models of evolution into, you know, to explaining various things, as you just said, social evolution, legal evolution, and even evolution in everyday life, you know, how we kind of, the pace of life is changing. So I think it's very nice observation. And also one thing that I think I learned new is that you interpret social evolution in terms of the technical, you know, the technical tools that become available. So it helps in the social evolution as well, like the social network and so on. So that's very nice observation. Thank you very much. And I think what you have written down should be recorded and you know, and then may be made available to all the group members. Thank you very much.
My handwriting is very bad. But my handwriting is very bad.
In Chinese?
No, my handwriting is very bad. It should be okay.
Right. Okay, so let's move to group number two. I think you have two presenters. Right, and you have flip chart to show. Good.
Thank you.
Thank you.
So essentially we were asked, you know, what else in fairy tales can we not do yet? And we were thinking of the story of Jack and the Giant Beanstalk and his magic beans. And we kind of thought, well, we actually already kind of have magic beans with genetically modified organisms. And we were thinking of how we can genetically modify them further to go to perhaps the level that they were magical in Jack's world, where they could grow to exponential levels. And we were thinking, you know, what possibilities could come from this? So we were thinking, in order to harness this power, we would need an increased potential of photosynthesis. We would have to be able to figure out how to make these plants grow faster and bigger. And from this, we could expand on our knowledge. We could solve world hunger, create carbo nanotube elevators. There would be a massive impact on the environment and a massive impact on economics. So I'll pass over to these guys who are going to talk about the potential of the carbo nanotube elevator.
Okay, with the recent advancements of biotechnologies in the world, we can count on the fact that we are rapidly advancing in nanotechnology also, and if we can combine them both, we can implement the carbon nanotube concept in every aspect of life. And there are very specific properties of carbon nanotubes which we can implement in real life, and one property of that is they can rapidly regenerate, literally, and they can specifically bind carbon molecules to themselves to increase their size. And there are several properties like strength, hardness, electrical and optical and thermal properties of them, which can be readily implemented in real life to save the environment and the economy and another many kind of things. Like carbon nanotube is extremely strong, and it can even exceed the strength of steel that we use in elevator, in bridges. So we can build bridges and elevators out of them, and there will be less probability of accident. And if we examine the kinetic properties of carbon nanotube, we find that they are very good ball bearings. And so we dispose of the elementary kind of what we use today, steel ball bearings. So we will never run out of resources. And because carbon is one of the most abundant element in the world. And about the electrical properties, the carbon nanotube has got a very rare property of photoluminescence. So if it is an excited state, the carbon nanotube can emit light, and it can be the solution, the green solution to the lighting problem, because it will not emit any greenhouse gases, and it will be like the lighting solution to the total world. And about the other properties of carbon nanotube, she is going to discuss.
Yeah, and I'm going to add a little bit more to those photoluminescence thing. Like he said, carbon nanotube has great optical properties, which specifically refers to absorption and photoluminescence. And then like those CNTs, and like let's focus on the photoluminescence part. And I'm going to elaborate a little bit more what he said. And then like photoluminescence is like light emission from any form of matter after the absorption of photons. And then so if we build a house or residence with carbon nanotubes, like which and like apply those carbon nanotubes to like houses, and then which will look like a giant beanstalk actually, it will actually solve light problems, and now we have, because the light built of carbon nanotubes, we won't need electricity to light up the house, and instead, when photons are sent from the sun in the daylight, the carbon nanotubes molecules would actually absorb those photons and actually emit light into the rooms.
Actually, we picked up this subject because this is more realistic, and we can hope that we can achieve it within 20 to 30 years. At the pace of recent advancement of technology. And there are several other implications like solving world hunger and impact on environment, which can literally save the world from its recent economic, political, social, and all other kinds of problems.
Yes, so I think we'll pass on to you to talk about the world hunger issue, which is very prevalent.
Okay, for the world hunger, as we know, the population is increasing. According to the United Nations, within 35 years, the world population will be increased by 33%, which means the food crisis will be grow much cruel. However, this magic bean, if it's possible, it will new source of food and our supply, so we can solve this in a good way. And then, part is back.
Okay, thank you.
<It's all. laughs>
Bit like pass the parcel, isn't it? So the impact on the environment would be huge. We would essentially solve so many issues with pollution with these fast-growing plants. You know, they would grow so quickly. If we could also harness the ability to use, you know, less water on these crops as well, that could have great impacts on the world. It would also be fantastic for people's health if we can be able to grow these plants so quickly. You know, fast food would become salads. You know, it would become vegetables and fruits. It wouldn't have to be, you know, greasy cheeseburgers anymore. Economically, these genetically modified organisms would change the world. Like, as we've already seen, just from what we've already achieved in the 20th century, the changes have been phenomenal. And we believe that from the technology that's present and from the technologies that could be achieved if we put in enough funding, these changes could come true in just 20 to 30 years. Thank you.
Thank you very much for two new versions of Jack and the Beanstalk. I think this is a very nice two nice examples. One is the GMOs, and of course this has great potentials, as you pointed out. I just want to say that in the real world, you know, although we might think, hey, this is great solution, why don't we adopt it, you might find to your surprise, as I did, that there are many people against GMOs, and they have such fears as the GMOs might sort of destroy everything, you know, natural in the world, destroy the environment and so on. So one of our tasks is really to explain very patiently to the people that, you know, we're looking for something safe that will be helpful, you know, to the world. And I tell you, it's not easy. So please go on with your science, but also have to, kind of patience with the people who will object to what we're doing, although we think we're doing something good. As for the carbon nanotube beanstalk, I think that's also a very good, very nice story. And I can't think of any minus effect that people will object to yet, but I do know that nano, you know, particles and so on do raise, you know, fears in many people, including journalists. They think that, you know, maybe the raw materials that we do, you know, something, you know, that they are so tiny that they can penetrate the skin, your lungs, and do something bad to your bodies and so on. Again, we'll have to make sure that all these things are safe and explain to the people. So thank you very much.
Thank you so much.
Just saying that we can be only grateful to the author of that fairy tale who gave us such concepts.
Very exciting, actually. Okay, group three. I think we should.
Yes. Is it visible to all? I hope not. Okay, that's right. Honorable Deputy Prime Minister, respected committee members, and my dear fellows. So what we did back in our camp was to divide our group and to try to answer the two questions separately. So my friend, Mr. Patel, will be answering the first question, what they discussed.
Okay, so I'm not going to exactly answer just the first because we mixed up the two a lot, and I'm going to speak as fast as possible because we have a lot to cover. So first we started off with literature because it sometimes is as far science as from science as we perceive it. Literature, in my perspective, is about understanding humans and human nature. So first point that came up was science fiction. It provides a window to a worldview in which is distinct from ourselves, but we can question ethics and morality, which is not possible in our world, although they are still relevant. And the second point that came up was scientific concepts as metaphors in literature, and that's so I gave an example of Primo Levi's The Periodic Table, in which the author, a Holocaust survivor, has written each chapter of his autobiographical piece after an element. and it has a great metaphorical linkages with elements, and this is like not really studied well because not many people have knowledge of both literature and science to know it, but I think scientific concepts can actually help us express ourselves better to explain certain human conditions that is not possible in other words, because Primo Levi's certain condition required him to go require the understanding of science. And then we moved on to art and spirituality and how they are linked to science. And so first point that came up was how meditation and other spiritual activities and other exercise have a distinct physiological effects going on underneath. And so those things can better explain art and spirituality. And it again recurs that there is certain evidences that spirituality is hardwired into the human brain in the limbic system. And so that gives us a new perspective of understanding what is supposed to be really opposite to the science for certain people. And then there is, of course, sports. So sports is basically, if you're supposed to be playing basketball or any other sport, is basically mechanics. And also, on the other hand, there is the physiological effects. Why sports is fun, the adrenaline and the other neurological receptors play, how they play into it. And then we moved on of how we perceive certain social sciences as distinct from it, even though we call them social sciences. And they, although they are not as rigorous, but they have the same process going back behind them. So the social sciences such as psychology and economics are just as important because they follow the same methodology certain times. And then we mentioned music as a treatment for certain kind of addictions or neurodegenerative diseases like Alzheimer's, and how they play into the treatment. And there are scientific evidence that they actually help us in that treatment. And then there is the economic modelings of population and other factors, which is heavily based on the mathematics and the dynamics. Also, the certain of economical theories have been inspired from physics, the equations that show up in physics. And that's why we need those understanding of maths and physics at certain times, and they can help us economically. And then there is the explanation of psychology behind the art interpretation. So again, it's again neuroscience, and how we have greater insight in why we interpret certain art as better art than the others, because there is a certain neurology behind it, such as why observing a Rothko, which is like blank piece of paper, induces certain emotions, and they have been studied neural circuits that explain it. And then there is the mathematics behind art and architecture. So people have already been discussing the role of the golden ratio phi that plays into certain paintings and in nature. And also there is the symmetry shown in architecture that requires both understanding of physics and mathematics, and yet it enhances the beauty of the structures that we use for practicality. And lastly, we mentioned, which is not exactly science, but technology, and how that influences politics, and sometimes they have been segregated out of the political discussions, but we have observed, such as the invention of nuclear weapons in the last half of the century, and how they have influenced politics, and historians are still debating the consequences if that had not been so. So these are all the points that we covered as a group, and now
we were given the second question. So first of all, I would like to elaborate on the second question. Our question was arts and humanities, application of science in these two subjects, because they are considered as non-science subjects. So I will try to be as brief, because we have not that much time. So due to lack of time, we were able to jot down these points. Now, I will be honest that he covered some of the points. So arts itself, it can be divided into painting, and it can be considered music. A type of art is also music. So one of our friend, he commented that it's not about making art, it's about preserving art. So science can be applied, actually it is being applied to the painting of Mona Lisa to preserve its color. And also, if we make some colors and some chemicals by using the knowledge of chemistry, we can make paintings that will have bright colors and that can last longer without any decomposition. And the painting will be very, very, you can say it will be very, very beautiful, and it will be a masterpiece. After that, the foundation of the painting. If we can apply chemistry to the foundation of painting, it will really, what it will do, it will make the paint stick to the painting and the paint will not fade off with time. So we can say that we can have a permanent painting of a kind. In humanity, one of our colleague was from economics. He also said that they use certain rules of science or mathematics, simple calculations, in their theories of economics to find, they use probability and stuff like that to calculate profit and loss. So in humanity, definitely science has a big role. And when you study philosophy, I think he has covered that, when you study philosophy, science has played a very vital role in philosophy, because before science, there were some statements that were not quite true. Due to science, the philosophy that we study today is very specific, and it's up to the, you can say, standards, and it is true now. You would like
just,
to add on?
I would just like to add upon philosophy, because the philosophers of the very early times were in fact considered scientists, and I think the contribution that they made today are talked about even today. And the scientists, what they do now is the work of the scientist goes into philosophy. So it's a kind of cycle, you can see. And I also believe that philosophy draws heavy a lot of knowledge from neurosciences, especially because it all depends upon how the human behavior is influenced by their thinking and their perception of the surroundings. So it is like people are heavily dependent upon the knowledge gathered by neuroscience. And also there's another thing which one of my friends they were talking about, that is we should also think about the great impact that science has on our daily lives, on especially on the civic life, and how we have there has been a great betterment of our civic life because of the contribution of science. And with respect to this, I would like to mention that the traffic problem has been a great major problem from a long time, and through special cameras installed at various locations, and through design of suitable procedures and rules, we have been able to cut down upon the problems of traffic jam and many more such issues. And another thing is the music, the effect of music that has on our minds. And especially one of my friends talked about music therapy. And yes, it is like a great aid to a lot of problems. And music really relieves the mind of many tensions and stress. And also when we talk about music, the musical instruments are not to be forgotten. Like every day probably hundreds and hundreds of musical instruments are coming up, and the sounds that are produced are really fine applications of sound, of the physics of sounds. And my friend would like to add upon this, maybe.
That's all. I will end because it's been time. So I would like to end by answering the question, are there applications of science in these subjects? The answer is yes.
Thank you very much. This group has a very hard task of being integrator. Integrates science with non-science. And I think you've done an admirable job in doing that, both in pointing out that there's many science concepts in the so-called the non-science subjects, and many applications in music, in art, in paintings, even in literature. And in literature in particular, I think this is a very fascinating subject, because science fiction is what I think is really the perfect application of the what if concept. You remember in my talk, imagination is really asking what if, and the science fiction's really asking what if, you know, in a very free manner. And this goes on to things like Jurassic Park and Jurassic World and so on. Some things almost could be true, but what if, you know, it extends reality a little bit. So I think this is very good. And for people who are thinking about their college, I think that it's worth thinking of, first of all, doing liberal education. That is not just a hard science subject as such, but for your first degree, liberal education. This will really kind of liberalize your mind, broaden your mind, so that you are ready for the next step of going into specialization. So that's one choice. I mean, many people may like to go into the hard area at first. That's up to you. So thank you very much.
Thank you all for your patience. Thank you very much.
So thank you all for, I mean, a very good discussion, actually. And then just at the end of this session, so I think maybe we should thank Honorable Deputy Prime Minister again, I mean, for his time this afternoon. Because, I mean, you know, he's so busy, and he spends the whole afternoon with us. So.
And I would like to thank all my helpers, the young helpers. Where are they all? Oh, they've gone home. They've gone home already? For next session, for their own sessions. So thank you very much, and especially all of you. Thank you very much for your nice contributions. Thank you.
So for the next session is the dialogue two. So group A, go to room 305. Group A, room 305. And group D is 405. Group D is 405. And if anyone is losing your notebook, please come to the front and get it. You're welcome.